I think it's raining here.
Let's make sure the slideshow works okay.
Yeah, sure. Just a second. Arun, can you just make him to host, please?
Is it?
Can you make Steve a host?
Yeah.
Co-host.
Yeah, I already made.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Oh, wait a second. I think I have to fix that. That's what I was missing. All right. So
Oh, looks good. Yeah.
That's full screen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Let's just make sure the video works.
Perfect. Yes.
John Anderson, you could use a Guinness right
about now.
Yeah. Getting sound?
Yes.
John Anderson. Good. All right. So we're good. Okay. Excellento. I should know this and I don't. Where are the students in their career? Are they like?
They are postgraduate students. They are graduate students and doing their post-graduation here.
Good. All right. I have a story to tell about graduate school. That's good. And how many students are we don't know, or I guess you do?
We are expecting at least 34.
Okay.
It's been a long day, you know, it's a whole day, you know, they had classes and it's Zoom fatigue.
Well, I'll see if I can make it entertaining. I should tell you, this is a deck that a bunch of people have asked me to do versions of this presentation over the last 3 or 4 months, and I've said no. And I finally buckled down about a month ago and started working on a way to tell this story that was both granular and interesting. And so this is the maiden voyage of this deck.
Oh, great. Excellent.
So you'll be my test audience.
Your privilege. Yeah.
Well, we'll see. I mean, audiences are different, as you know. Classrooms are classrooms. And the minute you're on Zoom, I don't know. It's a different way to teach, for sure.
Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm.
And yes, Zoom fatigue, I understand. You know, my schedule is back to back, you know, and then every now and then in the middle of the day, someone will throw in a Microsoft Teams call. I'm like, no.
I tell them about it.
So I'm trying to think of what else we need to do in advance. Timing wise, we have an hour.
Mm-hmm.
What's the best way to handle questions? We could do it kind of, we could ask people to raise their hand. We could have people pipe up. We could do it at the end.
No, they can, from our experience, you know, they can actually put the questions in the chat.
Okay, good.
Either you can ask if you wanted to ask, turn on the camera and ask, it's up to you, you know, or you can.
My preference would be to see people.
Okay.
Just because I like faces.
Yes. So drop a bus in the chat. So I'll just call them out.
All right. I would say this. I tend to be pretty interactive, so
yeah.
You know, I'd rather have it be back. You know, because people think they're going to ask the questions at the end, and then the end becomes a little formulaic. So But then we'll also leave some Q&A, some conversation at the end as well.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, part of what you're going to get to in this talk is it's either a really difficult time to be a journalist or a really exciting time to be a journalist.
Yeah.
And maybe both. But definitely, I'll tell the story.
Can I share this after the lecture? I have the copy, and can I share it with the students?
You can, but then will they jump ahead? You mean after? Sure. If you think that's the better way for them, sure. I mean, I tend to like to kind of do things in order, but as both my sons explained to me, Dad, that's not how we do it anymore. That's fine. I suppose there's no secrets in there. So the only interruption we may get in about 15 minutes is my wife is returning with our two dogs who are out for their morning walk. And so if you hear drama in the background, it's just the dogs.
All right.
I'm gonna jump off for just 1 second. I'll be back in a minute.
Yeah, sure.
Just let me know when you're ready to get started.
Yeah, we can get started.
Okay.
Steve, would you like to do a self-introduction on your own?
Well, sure. Well, I mean, that's kind of where the slides can do that as well.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So welcome everyone. I know it's the end of a long day and it's the beginning of my day, so I have my coffee. With that, this is going to be somewhat interactive. I'd be happy to have you ask questions in the chat, raise your hand, jump in, turn your video on. There's no reason not to. If I lose you in my storytelling, please feel free to just jump in and say, wait, go back, I don't understand. I'm told as a journalism professor and teacher that I am unusual. That may be a compliment or it may not. You'll have to decide for yourself. But I tend to tell very hard stories, often in somewhat lighthearted and trivial illustrations, because I think it's easy to lose the forest for the trees. And the other thing I will say, just before we get into the slides, is you're all very lucky. You're joining the field of journalism at a time when it's never been more important or more complicated or more in the midst of change. And I say that because how you behave as a journalist has the potential to change it. It will not be the same thing in 5 years that it is today. And that isn't abundantly clear anywhere in the world right now. It's in the United States where, you know, the election and the future of the democracy has been turned upside down by both journalism and whatever the other thing is, anti-journalism. We're going to talk about you know, misinformation a little bit as well. But let me start just by telling you a little bit about who I am. I'm joining you today for a number of reasons, but one is because I have been in media all my life. And when I say all my life, I literally mean since high school, which was a long time ago. I've given two TED Talks, well, or three, depending on how you count. This is from the main stage at the TED headquarters in New York, where I gave a talk about fake news a little more than 2 years ago. And I would share it with you, except that I think in retrospect, the world has changed so much that it is now essentially totally wrong. That's the speed at which the world we're living in is moving. I still like the talk. You're welcome to watch it. You can Google it. But I think you would take issue to some of the analysis that I made, and I do. And we'll talk about that. I also love technology. I love the tools. I love the phones. I love the headgear. I love the editing equipment. I've owned 5 companies. One of them was a great big post-production company back in the day. I like the hardware. We're going to talk about the importance of the hardware, but I'm not a hardware geek in the sense that if you gave me a tablet and a hammer and a piece of metal, I would bang out a story in it. If you gave me an iPhone, I would tell a story with that. If you gave me Google Slides, as we're using today, I would tell you a story with that. I think the tools give us new ways to tell stories, but I don't think that the technology should shape our storytelling. And then this word curation, which now seems a little antiquated. Many years ago now, I became convinced that there was this new way to organize information that wasn't creation, but wasn't also at the same time just algorithmic, you know, aggregation. And so I tested this word curation. Nobody could come up with a better word. I wrote a book. The book did really well. And for a bunch of years, I was the curation guy. I think curation is part of what we're going to talk about today as well. But this is the picture that I've never shared with anyone before. Literally, this is my maiden voyage, outing myself in an honest and slightly charming way. I was, the thing that probably shaped my personality the most was that I was a magician. And when I say magician, I don't mean coins and cards and little, you know, pocket magic. I mean, I traveled with an illusion show. I had 5 birds. I had a rabbit. I cut a woman in half with a great big bandsaw. And my name on stage was Black Star. I thought the other day as I was putting the slide deck together, would that be politically inappropriate today? Would that be like, would I not be able to use that name in the current world? I don't know the answer to that. But the reason why being a magician has driven my career and my journalism career is because, well, here, this is the slide I want to, well, hold on. It is because magic is in many ways the way technology looks to people who can't, you know, when things become so extraordinary that you can't imagine how they're done, it's magical. And I think as journalists, what you're all going to face, I mean, just by way of example, I asked a technologist friend of mine the other day, how long will it be before he'll be able to take this video of me and make a video in which I say something completely antithetical to my beliefs and share it with my mother such that she will actually believe that I am saying something terrible without being able to tell that it's, you know, a deep fake. And he paused for a moment and said, probably 3 months. I said, you mean 3 months to make it? And he said, oh, no, it'll take 10 minutes to make it. 3 months before the technology. So we are 3 months away, or arguably you've all seen the tech, maybe it's now, but it's certainly not 5 years, that someone will send a video to one of your colleagues of you saying something about a person or about a fact that will be so dramatically. So as a journalist, someone will send you a video and say, you know, Donald Trump has accepted that Joe Biden is going to be president, and they'll send you a video and it will just be completely manufactured. And that's, we're right at the verge of magic taking over journalism in some ways that is going to be challenging for all of you. So very quickly, how I got here today, I've done 5 companies. I did a little video company in upstate New York a million years ago called Our Town TV that was truly, honestly, and I say this with all humility, really terrible. I mean, really the worst local TV you could ever imagine. And people loved it. Then I did a series on MTV called Unfiltered, in which we FedExed cameras to members of the audience and they recorded their stories. That if you have spare time and decide I'm an interesting person, Google it. The stories are, I think, some of the best work I've ever done. Then I did a film about 9/11 called 7 Days in September. Then I bought a company from Cory Booker, who's now a US Senator, called Waywire. I've done a couple of TED Talks and I'm now at the NYC Media Lab. And that's where I sit today, running a small team of university consortium experts trying to think about the future of media and journalism. And just very briefly, the Media Lab is a consortium of these 6 universities, NYU, Columbia, CUNY, and then a series of big media and brand companies all based in New York and around the world. And it's a great gig. And I really like the people I work with. And we're really trying to, if not solve problems, at least ask hard questions. And we're gonna do some of that today. So today we're gonna do 4 things. We're gonna look at the history of media very briefly, because I assume as graduate students, most of you know this stuff. Then we're gonna look at technology specifically. Then we're gonna look at society and sociology. And then finally, we're gonna look at government. So with that, when you put those 4 things together, the change that we're facing, is profound. And this is why I started the talk by saying, the good news is that you'll be at an exciting moment. And the bad news is, you know, you're at an exciting moment. All right, so let's just start into media broadly for a second. You know, until very recently, we knew what it was. We knew why it mattered. But today the definitions are changing. Fact versus fiction is no longer clear. I mean, just by way of example, you know, another example of technology changing very quickly, the green screen backgrounds that some of you are using at the moment is still just blurry enough around the edges that you can pretty much tell it's pasted in there. That's gonna last about another 10 seconds. So 10 seconds from now, someone's going to send you a video sitting in their office. And if you look really closely, you'll know that they're sitting in their living room and that that's a green screen background. And that's, I mean, we've seen that improve on Zoom measurably in the last 6 months, and it will continue to be. And I don't know if I assume that you've all played with Snapchat filters as well. I mean, you know, they're getting better and better to the point where, you know, I'll be able to change my glasses. I'll be able to change the beard I'm wearing. I'll be able to change the color of my hair or no hair. These things are all going to happen. And it will, you know, this whole, you know, you guys are young enough that you don't remember this phrase being kind of nomenclature, but seeing is believing. What there's a whole generation that actually believe that pictures and then video reflected facts, and they no longer do. This is not a incremental change for you. This is a career challenge, because the sheer content, that the volume of content that we have coming at us blurs the lines between, you know, what we read, listen to, or watch, and everything being called into question. You know, Facebook in particular is looking at a million pieces of content before it decides the one it's going to put in your feed, or 10 million or 100 million. So the question isn't what they put in your feed, although we're going to talk about that. It's what they choose not to put in your feed. And so as journalists, the question is, do you write something or make a video or make an Instagram post that is thoughtful, interesting, even tempered, and potentially invisible? Or do you write or publish something salacious, dramatic, moderately inaccurate, but wildly popular? And while that's an easy question to answer, you know, sitting in a graduate program, it becomes a harder question to answer when there's pressure on journalists to keep their jobs and people are being measured on, you know, and your boss looks at the results of a post that does really well for them and says, good job. And by the way, this is not a new thing, just so you know. I mean, I've been in journalism and film and television my whole life. Everything has been measured on size of audience. I mean, when I made a documentary for the History Channel or A&E, the ones that got the most positive feedback from management were the ones that garnered the most audience. So this is not a new thing. By the way, I made a decision to use the word media in this frame, not journalism, not storytelling, not writing, not photography, because increasingly everything is media. I mean, the New York Times makes media, you know, Facebook, it makes media. And I think one of the things that you all are lucky enough to have been born at a moment where some of these decisions have been made already is I think trying to say to people, no, that stuff on Facebook, that's just social media. I'm making journalism. I have a degree. Look, here's my membership card. I don't think the readers and the users and the consumers accept that distinction anymore. Best way that I know to describe that is just go spend a little bit of time on Reddit, if you haven't already. I mean, on Reddit, fact, fiction, humor, jokes, memes, links, all blur together into kind of the zeitgeist of the moment. So this is really why the magic story and the journalism story cross for me. This is Arthur C. Clarke, who's a fabulous science fiction writer. And the quote is, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. If you have to get a tattoo and you want my advice, I would say maybe it would be an erasable tattoo, not a permanent ink tattoo. But that, I think about this quote a lot, because at the moment, you know, it's easy to say, we just have to teach the audience to distinguish between fact that we have to do better journalism education and media literacy and get them to be able to, indistinguishable. Your work and the work of someone trying to use these tools in a way that will convolute truth or present misinformation is indistinguishable from the facts. So that's what you're up against. By the way, my dogs have come home. So we're going to talk about how media evolves, and specifically about it used to be expensive, complicated, hard to make, but now it's democratized. And I have to tell you, one of the things as I wrote this slide that I found painful is, you know, I'm probably one of a handful of people responsible for that. At least maybe it was going to happen anyway, and I just was in the right place at the right time. But if you look at MTV Unfiltered, it was specifically conceived to give passive audiences the tools to be able to join the storytelling revolution. And I was really proud of that. Don't think we fully thought through the implications of that evolution. So three things have changed. Devices, connectivity, and platforms.
Unexpectedly, irrespective of age and gender.
Hello? Was that a question?
What I can answer.
Say again. I heard age and gender. I'm happy to answer if you want to ask again. I'm going to keep going. Okay. So there's this old internet joke. No one knows if you're a dog. But the reality is no one does know if you're a dog. And in fact, if you look at the data, there are some very, very, very famous Instagram dogs. Jif Palm has 9 million followers on Instagram. Doug the Pug comes in second at 3.8 million. I am sorry to tell you that my dogs do not have Instagram accounts. They're just too busy to be bothered with social media. So let's do the numbers, because the numbers are going to be, I think, revelatory. I used US numbers in part because I had access to them, but you know, please feel free to jump in if you think that the numbers in India are dramatically different than these. I think you'll find they probably are not. So let's just start to set the stage with digital in the Americas. This is 2020, this is recent data. So the good news is I'm not digging back to 2016. Total population, 1.2 billion in the Americas. Total mobile phone connections is 1.05 billion. So already, essentially that means, you know, very high ratio of mobile phone connections to users. Internet users, 776 million, which begs the question of what the other 200 million are doing with their phones, I guess, voice. And then active social media users, and this is the number on this page that I found kind of most startling, 678 million. So well over two-thirds of all connected users are using social media. And it's almost time to retire the phrase social media, because I think it suggests it's something off to the side of mainstream, as opposed to what it really is, which is the internet, such as it is. All right. And by the way, this is data from Hootsuite. Yeah, go ahead. All right. So really what these numbers are showing is urbanization versus population. 76% penetration, and then active social media users 67%. Which is to say, if we were to, like, less fancy, but boil this down, let's just kind of put a little sketch in our notepad for this. This is essentially everyone, right? That's a lot. All right, next, let's talk about daily time spent with media. And let's put a footnote in this that that Zoom and all of our lives and are hopefully not going to last forever. And maybe that's not, I mean, that's not what these numbers reflect. So what we're going to look at is daily using the internet, 6 hours 43 minutes a day. Using social media, 2 hours, 24 minutes a day. Watching television, 3 hours, 18 minutes a day. Listening to streaming music services, 1 hour, 26 minutes a day. And using game consoles, 1 hour, 10 minutes a day. The point is, where does your work as a journalist squeeze into this time frame? Is it the watching television number? Probably not. Is it social media? Maybe. Not streaming, not gaming, although gaming maybe eventually. But of the 6 hours and 43 minutes a day of people using the internet, you know, I think the reason I wanted to show you these numbers is this is what you're up against. This is the flood of entertainment and distractions and music and conversation and dog pictures and games that your journalism is trying to break through. And if it feels like there's a fire hose of noise that you and you're trying to be relevant within it, you're not wrong about that. There is. I want to go back. So these are just the percentages watching. What are people doing with online activities? Watching online videos, 90%. Watching vlogs, although I'm not sure I know what that word means anymore. 751 streaming services, radio stations, and podcasts. Podcasts is a big number. That, by the way, is worth putting a little bit of a pin in. As a journalist, if you aren't a guest on podcasts, participating in podcasts, making podcasts, it's probably worth thinking about your career trajectory because podcasting is clearly on the rise and is going to be a critical way to distribute information. So where does this all take us? And now I'm going to visit a little bit of science fiction. I live in New York. I walk down the street. By the way, everyone wears a mask, literally everyone. I see more and more parents pushing strollers with children with an iPhone or an iPad in their stroller. I think I maybe used to be more judgmental about people's parenting. Now I pretty much feel like people do what they do. That being said though, this picture of this little girl holding this iPhone made me think about a book that I read a long time ago. I don't know how many of you have read Neal Stephenson. It's funny, people don't talk much about science fiction at the moment. It may just be that science fact has gotten so blurred with science fiction, it seems less, I don't even know what, mind-blowing. But this book, I'm gonna recommend a couple books over the course of this talk. But this book talks about something called The Young Girl's Primer. And it's a little handheld device that the lead character in the book is given to help her navigate the world around her. And I couldn't help but think that it feels very much like an iPhone in this photograph. So we're gonna jump back just for a second, and then now we've kind of put the brackets on the conversation we're gonna have. The future with children and iPhones, the future of internet, the use of internet, and then how did we get here? So, you know, looking forward is often in the realm of prognosticators, but it's worth remembering that science fiction doesn't always become science fact. It's worth looking back at how radio, newspapers, and TV impacted print and how other internet impacted all other forms of creation and distribution. I mean, the story that I was told, and I love this story, is that when Ted Turner was beginning to create CNN, he was asked if he'd done any audience research. Did he know that people wanted a 24-hour news channel? And he said, with his typical bravado, well, no, research is bullshit. And I think the truth of the matter is, you know, if someone had said, if they'd done the research back then and said, do you want more news? Would you like to have a news channel on 24 hours a day? The answer would have been a resounding no. People would have said, I'm good. I don't need any more news than I'm getting. And by the way, one could make the argument that a lot of the things, you know, the problem with the cable news world all over the planet is that it creates this massive shelf space that then has to be filled with either hardcore journalism or garbage noise. You decide which. But I think the question I would ask you as journalists is, what's the next big thing that is going to create shelf space that your work is going to sit in? And is that virtual reality? Is it augmented reality? Is it gaming? Is it, you know, something with headwear? Is it, you know, is it computer human interface? I mean, there are going to be things you can see on the horizon that are going to need journalism. So now let's talk about data. And again, I'm using this word on purpose. And there are friends of mine in the journalism world, some of them I suspect are you guys, who will find this word of conflating journalism and data incredibly annoying. I'm okay with that. Way back in the day, data was music, phone calls, telephone calls, typewriters, audio recordings, you know, plus of course numbers, calculations, but for the media data for the purposes of this talk. It was manageable. You could turn it off. Jump forward 10 years, 15 years, and all of a sudden we have photographs, we have video, we have video games, we've got computer discs, we've got, you know, all these other forms of digital information that are now competing with what was the charming turn on the TV, turn on the radio, kind of simple media. And now we get to today. And today it's just a mess. And not only is it a mess, but all of these different forms of information and media are competing. The only thing that hasn't changed in these 50 years is your need to get 6 or 7 hours sleep, get up, work, earn a living, do your schoolwork. I mean, all of this media is fighting to get the same amount of brain space that it used to get when there was one or two of them. And that, I think, is the challenge for journalism and for all of you. So here comes AI. AI rolls in and says, there are 10,000 pieces of information in the world that all theoretically would be interesting to you. You have time to consume 5 of them. How are we going to filter these such that the 10,000 end up being a coherent feed to you? And while the challenge of this and the danger of it is that while AI is on one hand really appealing because the volume isn't going to go down, so we've got to have a filter. At the same time, it's going to be influenced by things that might not get you the best result. So something beautiful or something subtle or something new or something nuanced is going to be replaced by, you know, I give it as an example, you know, your refrigerator. I assume if I came to your apartment or your house and I looked in your refrigerator, I would see some vegetables, some healthy foods. And then somewhere in the refrigerator, in the freezer side, I would see a quart of ice cream. Imagine if you opened that refrigerator and there was no cold area, just a freezer, and it was all ice cream. At some point you would say, that's bad. And then the next day you'd say, ah, that's bad. And then by the third day, you'd be like, what should I have for breakfast? I know, ice cream, because that's what's in the fridge. So if what AI does is only feeds to you the things that are the most salacious, the most overwhelming, the most dramatic, the things that are the most potentially shareable, then at some point we all become numb to the complexities of journalism. And as someone in the journalism career, all of you are faced with a really serious problem, which is Do you go into the ice cream business? It's profitable. It's what your boss wants. It's the best way to earn a living. It's the best way to get accolades. People will hear about you if you're more salacious. Or do you try and find some way to do something more nutritious and subtle? And I don't have a good answer for that today, but I think it's the question of our time. So let's look at data type. This is 2020 right here. And we're looking at about just slightly under 60 zettabytes of entertainment, non-entertainment images and video, productivity, and embedded links. And as you can see, the rise of that arc is, I mean, from 2015 to 2020, you know, is measurable and meaningful, but you're all smart enough to know that what I'm about to show you is the big white space to the right of your screen, which is where the real story is. So that's where we're going. That's the ice cream to nutrition challenge that you all face, which is that the volume is growing exponentially. It is going to be overwhelming. Journalism is going to be fighting with games and cartoons and salacious bits and misinformation and fake news and you know, you're up against a tough battle. And it used to be, if you could go back in a time machine, that you guys were safe, because the institutions that publish legitimate journalism would say, listen, this is our public service area. We're not measuring it on commercial standards. So, you know, as long as you do a good job and we win, you know, a Peabody or a couple of awards, we're going to be okay with journalism not being an audience getter. That is no longer the case. So, you know, your bowl of peas is up against a quart of ice cream. Wow, that's depressing. I didn't mean to make that so dark. There's good news at the end, I promise. So let's talk about technology and how we can expect developments in creation and consumption of content to impact the definition of what we expect from media. How the emerging worlds of virtual reality and augmented reality will drive change in existing media and information and the company as companies and platforms evolve. I don't know if any of you have seen this clip. I'm just going to play it. It's about 30 seconds.
John Anderson, you could use a Guinness right about now.
Stressed out, John Anderton.
Is it fun at all, Harrison? Get away, John Anderton. Forget your troubles. What's so, John Anderton?
Hello, Mr. Yakamoto. Welcome back to the Gap. How those assorted tank tops work out for you?
Mr. Yakamoto.
So.
Oops. John Anderton! Okay.
One second. There we go. So the reason why that clip is important is that when Minority Report was produced, it was science fiction. Today, that's essentially what the internet is, right? I mean, you troll around the internet. The internet notices where you're pausing and stopping and clicking, and then advertisers decide that they're going to show you more of those things. I don't know how many of you own AirPods, but you know, I avoided them for a very long time. I don't know why. And I got my first pair, I don't know, 6 months ago, 7 months ago, and then lost one. My dog ate it, actually. And I felt incredibly naked. I'm not wearing them now. They don't speak to my presentation software very well, but the idea that I could be walking through a mall wearing my AirPods and those digital billboards could know who I am and speak to me, again, you know, much like the question of when you know, fake news is going to become the same as real news, that is a easily deliverable product today. I could build that tomorrow. So let's now talk about society and sociology. When this program posted a video, I guess it was 2 days ago, about me speaking, it went up on Facebook and I got a Google News alert and I went and looked and it had been viewed 82 times. And that made me very happy that 82 people were interested in my talk. I don't know what the measure of what I would have been unhappy with, but increasingly, you know, in the same way that when I go to work and people say, Steve, those are nice glasses, or I really like your sweater, or like, hey, nice shoes, or shoe, whatever. Like, when people give you social feedback, it feels good. And so here, let's just watch a quick clip from Black Mirror.
Hi there, how you doing?
I am wonderful.
I am so sorry, that flight is canceled.
No.
Customer incident at the other end.
What? So when is the next flight?
Yeah, they're all kind of full.
I booked this weeks ago. It's my best friend's wedding.
I'm sorry.
I have to get there. I have to.
Okay, let's see what we can do.
Oh, thank you.
I see there's one standby seat on another plane leaving tonight.
Oh, okay.
That's reserved for members of our Prime Flight program. You gotta be a 4.2 or over to qualify.
Oh, I'm a 4.2.
I'm afraid you're actually a 4.183.
Oh. Well, that's not my fault. Some woman dinged me down in the cab drive. Can't you just...
I'm sorry, it won't let me book it without the correct ranking.
But it's so close.
There's just nothing I can do.
Christ, I mean, surely.
I'm gonna have to ask you to moderate your language then.
Sorry, it's just... I'm maid of honor. I cannot miss this wedding.
And I am so sorry about that.
Can you call the supervisor?
I cannot do that.
Can you just call the supervisor?
I cannot do that.
Call the fucking supervisor.
Okay, that's profanity. We're zero tolerance on profanity.
I'm sorry, it's just...
Yeah, I have to serve the next customer.
No.
Can you step away, ma'am?
God, just fucking help me! I'm so sorry.
I've called security.
No, please.
So, I would say that's funny, but it's not funny, right? I mean, it's not funny for a variety of reasons. One, I had an incident like that, not terribly different than that, minus the social media button at an airport many years ago when I was trying to get on a plane and they called security. So I resonate with that moment. But, you know, the reality is, if you look at your life and you look at the things that you're measured on, I mean, you know, how is that any different than a frequent flyer mile program? I'm sorry, you're not a silver, you're not a gold, you're not a, like, I mean, this idea that we're going to be measured, and if I don't know if you remember that clip, it's from Black Mirror, and it's profoundly disturbing about how much this computer can determine our value. And we're there. I mean, neither the clip that I showed you from the Minority Report film nor that are unreasonable. They're all current. So now let's get to something that's not science fiction, but is actually science fact. I don't know if you know Trevor McFedries. He's a DJ, he's an artist. He's the owner of Brud, and he created a character called Lil Miguela. And she is a global influencer. She is a digital character, and she is incredibly popular. So I want to show you a clip of hers.
You never say how you really feel. How can I know if this thing is real? Is it all in my head? Am I making it up? Am I thinking too much? Why can't I just say it? Cause even if it's just in my mind, my heart is still hurting, so I know.
I can heavily relate to anyone who's ever felt out of place.
Because you're a robot.
I find that unbelievably stunning because she is on one hand incredibly charming and attractive and warm and speaks multiple languages, and but also we've crossed the line between there being this gets back to the real versus fake. So what is she? Is she a real character? Absolutely. Do audiences have relationships with her? Absolutely. At what point does this shift into the world that you guys are operating in? Well, why don't I just show you the clip?
现场的各位朋友，大家好，欢迎来到新华社。我是由新华社和搜狗公司联合培育的全球首个AI合成女主播，我的名字叫辛小萌。 我的声音和外形脱胎于新华社新媒体中心新闻主播曲芒，我将会在今年全国两会期间与大家见面。我和我的搭档。Which
is to say, we are now in a moment where you should be able to tell your newscaster, I would prefer a woman over a man, I would prefer an Asian woman over an American woman, I would prefer a woman of color, I prefer somebody speaking this language. I'd like them to speak a little more quickly. I'd like them to speak a little more slowly. I'd like this kind of a dialect. I mean, that's all completely doable. Which puts you, all of you, at a shocking disadvantage, right? Because you only get to be you. Well, unless you decide to wear an avatar. But I got into an argument years ago with Alexis Ohanian about what he calls pseudonymity. And I felt strongly, passionately, that people should sign their own name and there should be real ID. And he just told me I was wrong. And now I look back on that argument, it's probably 3 years ago now, four. And I see his point, which is, should each of you as journalists inhabit five different personalities? Should you have a male personality, a trans personality, a female personality? Should you be a dog? Perhaps you should be a dog. It might be that that's the best way to express yourself if you're covering, you know, pet care. I actually like that idea. I might do that. I want to make sure we have time for some conversation. So I'm not going to play the Tristan Harris clip, because I think that if you haven't watched the social, I keep wanting to call it the social network, but obviously that's not what it is. The Center for Humane Computing says, if you're not paying for the content, then you're the product. And Tristan has a very thoughtful comment about that, which I'll share. So let's just get into where we are today. Here's some data from the Center for Humane Technology. Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news. By the way, if that doesn't put a lump in your throat, it should. 75% of screen content is viewed for less than 1 minute. So if you met someone yesterday, sent me a link to a video they wanted me to share, and it was 14 minutes long. And I just remember thinking, with appropriate respect to my dear friend, is he crazy? Like, no one's gonna watch 14 minutes of your blather. I mean, it was actually a nice video, but I wasn't gonna share it. I mean, I'll share it, but people will watch less than a minute. And then 30% of 18 to 44 year olds feel anxious if they haven't checked Facebook in the last 2 hours. A recent survey of over 2,000 American adults indicate an incident of potential warning signs of Facebook addiction. This hour that I'm spending with you guys is the longest amount of time in my day when I'm not going to be checking my email or Twitter or Facebook. So, although I don't really feel anxious, I don't think. Three more bits of data. 50% of parents report that mobile devices typically interrupt time they spend with their children 3 or more times each day. Getting back to that picture of the little girl with the phone. 89% of cell phone users admit to using their phone during their last social gathering. And children who've been cyberbullied are 3 times more likely to contemplate suicide. So not only is this moment we're in dangerous and complicated and hard for journalism, but it's also dangerous for us as human beings and as a society. Now, there's an argument to be made that we will look back on this moment in time and that social media let run amok will look like the way we think about cigarettes today. Like, it's possible that we will begin to find some ways to limit people's access to unfiltered, unmanaged, raw information through the internet, through app, not through the internet to be clear, but through closed networks like Facebook, YouTube, Reddit, Twitter. But I'm not sure that's the case. And I don't think there's any evidence that it's gonna go in that direction. So now let's talk about government, which is our last little blip on the screen here. So in the US, there is something called Section 230. I don't know if you've studied it or not, but it is the Communications Decency Act. And it is the thing that allowed these networks to grow essentially with no responsibility for what they say or do. It says that Facebook is not a publisher, it's a platform, and that they can't be held responsible for anything that they put on their network. It was the thing that let the internet grow, that let social, the web grow quickly. And I think it's probably outlived its usefulness, but this is an article that I wrote 6 or 7 months ago. And Joe Biden had said at that point quite clearly that Section 230 was going to be either rewritten or revoked under his presidency. The rumor mill that I'm hearing from people in the Federal Communications Commission is that that might not be the case now. He may be backing off on that. I mean, these are great, big, powerful companies with a fire hose of lobbyists and a lot of money. So is the solution government regulation? Is it the repeal of platform versus publishers distinctions? Today, Facebook trades on attention and that is incentivized to publish information that is salacious and often untrue. There's no easy answer, but Harris calls it a cancer on society. So I started out this talk by saying it's very exciting that you all are arriving at journalism at this moment in time, but it's also daunting. And I think the answer is both. So what's next? Quick conclusions, very high level, and then we'll have just a few minutes to talk. Data is going to grow. Machines will make more content information, will make more content. Machines will read, process, prioritize more information. Call that whatever you will. Facial recognition will increase algorithmic inequalities, inequities. Synthetic media, which is machine-created characters like Lil Miguel, will become normalized. We'll expect them. So-called fake news, salacious news, will grow and be shared much faster than what has historically been called factual information. That's what you're up against. Consumers will be unable to distinguish between content or sources. Consumers will affiliate with sources that reflect their values and ideas. Advertisers will increasingly target and customize to meet consumer interests. Consumers will expect and get control of their data. That's a good one, by the way. Put a little positive check mark next to that. And the risks and trade-offs of free content and services will drive consumers to more subscription models. So power will lie in what I call information provenance. Not just who, I want to know about everything that comes to me, where it came from, who made it, and who altered it. The subject, the source, and the point of view. And this is the big idea of this talk because it's where journalism comes in. It's you publish it, you own it, and when people manipulate your information, it's not your name on it anymore. So with that, we are out of time. We have 5 minutes for questions. You can find me on Future Forward, which is my weekly podcast. You can find me on Media Insider on Media Post. I'm also on Twitter and LinkedIn and Facebook and Instagram, and look forward to your questions. Also happy to take email steve@nycmedialab.org. So with that, we are out of time. Did I bum you out? Oh, look, there's, see, I didn't see the chat questions. Here we go. Okay. No chat questions. Questions in the 5 minutes remaining.
Yeah, who wants to go first?
So I had a question.
Yes.
So I'm Ananya. So there was this recent Netflix film also, Social Dilemma, which is on the subject of how the social media world is actually, it presented a very grim picture. You know, it told about how while we call drug users, social media, we also call social media users. It's similar to like illegal drug users. And there was also this quote that how some of the best minds in the world are used to produce this clickbait that we see in different websites. So how do you see, like, in the presentation also, it was actually a very, if we look at it, our opportunities and all of this, it showed that it presented a very grim picture. So what do you think, how is it going to affect the world of journalism?
So I don't know that I would say grim. So here's what I think. This gets back to my ice cream analogy. So tell me about, well, let me ask you a question. Tell me about, like, where do you publish information? Where, if I were to find you, are you on Instagram? You're on WeChat? Where do people hear your voice?
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter.
Do you have a following?
Not many. Not a, like, great following too. Not a, like, very few, not much, like.
So I think the answer to the question of the way that we've, so there's a, you know, there's no one, there's nothing, no button we're going to push that makes Facebook, is going to make Facebook stop minting money. So I think there's going to be government change. I think there's change coming from Europe to the US about privacy. I think your ability to control your data is going to be part of that. But I also think, there are women like you who would like to hear your voice. And what I say to journalists is you have to figure out who you want to speak to. And you need to begin to build a consistent voice. Like, the way that we solve the grim Facebook story is by replacing it with good people telling interesting human personal stories about their work. And if, you know, I have 20,000 Twitter followers. Some of them are robots. But I make an effort to publish every day things that I think are relevant, and I respond to people and I interact with people. And it's work, by the way. I mean, it's not, you know, it's effort. But I think that we, as journalists, it's almost like the word journalist means so many different things. You have to, part of what I would challenge you to think about is, what kind of journalist do you want to be? Like, do you want to be do you want to have a voice? Do you want to be a character? Do you want people to follow you? We probably don't have enough time to get into career counseling, but like, I don't think we're going to solve the Facebook movie is grim. There is no doubt. That's Tristan Harris's movie. And everyone should watch it, The Social Dilemma, if you haven't. But the question is now, what do we do? All right, we have another question.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi. First of all, thank you for the wonderful talk. It's been very informative. And secondly, I want to ask you that when governments themselves turn instigators and churners of fake news, in that, like, especially in countries like India, where that is a huge menace, how can we as citizens protect ourselves better and, you know, fight this?
It's a big question. Well, I mean, I'm not in India, I'm in the US, but we have a government that's publishing fake news rather prolifically. I think what scares me, the reason why I like talking to you guys is because, like, none of you are saying, I know, let's go back to when I was, like, no one wants to go backwards. So I think the answer to the question is, you know, be wary of things like I look at the way China manages the internet, and I think that that should be a greater concern on the in the global stage, that there isn't free access to information in China is, I think, a big deal. I think it's also worth being honest about, you know, the things that we're attracted to that maybe aren't necessarily factual. So if somebody publishes something terrible about you that's completely untrue, you could spend, I'm in a debate right now on Facebook with someone who is suggesting that Trump won the election. And there's no evidence to back that up. There's no facts to back that up. But he keeps pointing me to other, you know, to the Washington Examiner. And I'm like, yeah, the Washington Examiner is not like it's almost like we keep tattooing ourselves with the word journalist and thinking that somehow that rises us above them. But you know, whenever people say, well, we should only trust real journalism, my answer is, okay, what do you call Fox News? And it's like, because if you call Fox News real journalism, like I think it's almost like at the end of the day, if every one of the students in this class committed to publishing, and by the way, at scale, interesting, thoughtful, human, accurate, referenced, linked material on a regular basis, we could rise above the noise. But the government concern is a real one, and you're right to raise it. And I don't have an easy answer. In the US, I don't have an easy answer. I mean, I don't want the internet regulated. But all right, we have time for one more. It's actually 9 o'clock my time, which means 7:30 your time. All right, well, then we're going to drop off. Thank you all. Thanks for taking the time. Any questions, feel free to reach out.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Steve. Have a nice day.
All right, bye.